Grace to you and peace from God our Father and our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. An old man limps into his doctor's office and says, "Doctor, my knee hurts so badly that I can hardly walk." Well, the doctor examines him for a moment and looks him in the face and thinks for a second and says, "Well, sir, can you tell me how old are you?" And the man proudly replies, "I'm 98 years old." Well, the doctor sighs, looks him once over again and says, "Sir, I don't mean any disrespect, but you're almost 100 years old. And you're complaining that your knee gives you pain? What else did you expect?" To which the man replies, "Well, my other knee is 98 years old and it doesn't hurt at all." 98 years old and one bad knee, I think that guy's doing pretty well. What do you think? Now, some of you have express concern for me that in recent years you've noticed that sometimes I walk with a limp. I do appreciate your concern. I thank you for that. My concern over those same years has been that my manner of walking doesn't distract you in your worship experience. For 10 years now, I've been living with osteoarthritis, and it mostly affects my knees. And what I would want you to know is that over these years, I have availed myself of numerous medical treatments, also home remedies, which continue to come in and be suggested to me. Also, and perhaps more importantly, over these years, I have done everything I possibly can to stay active. And I think that has really helped. My daily life is characterized by staying ahead of this disease and even outperforming it. And I'd also want you to know that a lot of the times when you say something about my limping, I don't even know that I'm doing it until you point it out to me. It's that become that much a part of who I am. And then from a faith perspective, this has been for me opportunities. I have daily opportunities, and I have daily reminders of my need for God. And so this illness over the years has actually helped me to stay close to God and has brought me back to God. And I think that's the case, is it not, for any one of us? That in our times of weakness, our times of pain, our times of doubt, our times of sorrow, whatever that may look like and feel like, we can remember, and we do remember in a profound way, that we can lean on God and that we can rely on God. In our first reading for today from the book of Genesis, one of our Old Testament ancestors of the faith, Jacob, spent the later years of his life walking with a limp. In Genesis 32, where our reading comes from, we hear the story of how Jacob wrestles with God and how he leaves that encounter with a blessing, with a new name, and with a profound limp. But before we get to that story, there may be some things that we want to remember about Jacob in his younger life. The story of Jacob in Genesis begins at chapter 25, verse 19, with his birth, and then is summed up for the most part in Genesis 37, the first two verses, and the story goes on to Jacob's sons, particularly Joseph. I would commend these chapters to you. There is as much drama and intrigue and scandal in these chapters as there is in any Lifetime movie. So I think you would enjoy the read. You would not be bored by it by any means. But Jacob when he is born, he is the younger of twin brothers. His brother's name is Esau. And Esau and Jacob have Isaac as their father, and Abraham as their grandfather. And early in his life as a young man, with the help of his mother, Jacob devises a scheme to trick Esau out of his birthright as the firstborn. He disguises himself as his brother, and he takes advantage of his father's diminishing eyesight to receive this firstborn's blessing. And then, for fear of his brother's wrath, Jacob decides that he needs to leave, to go into a foreign land. And so Jacob travels to Haran, where he meets up with his uncle Laban. And there at Haran, Jacob manages to find a way to cheat Laban's sons out of the best pieces of land and the best of the livestock. Also, while he's there, he takes as his wives Laban's daughters, Leah and Rachel. Jacob then figures that he's worn out his welcome with Laban's family. And so he takes all that he has. He takes his herds, he takes his wives and his sons and his daughter, and decides that he will make a return trip to Israel. He sends a messenger ahead of him to his brother Esau to let him know that he's coming. And Esau's response to the news is to start out along the road to meet his brother. Jacob is fearful that his brother's intention is to do him harm, and so Jacob sends ahead of him gifts of reconciliation and peace. And that is where we find ourselves in the story of Jacob in chapter 32. Today, because it's on this journey of anticipation and anxiety and fear, that Jacob finds himself alone in the middle of the night and wrestling with God. Now, throughout his life up to this point, Jacob had his moments where he was thankful to God. He prayed to God for God to continue to bless him and to do good by him. But more than that, Jacob, up to this point in his life, was the type of person who wanted to take matters into his own hands. He had already done his own share of trickery and scheming for his personal gain. But we also hear in these chapters that others had deceived him and schemed against him as well, in particular, his father-in-law, Laban. So this is a crucial moment for Jacob. This is a crucial moment for the people of Israel who he represents. And in this moment, a wrestling match ensues between an imperfect Jacob and with God. And Genesis 32 tells us that in that struggle, Jacob gave it everything that he had. And he was a formidable and he was a strong opponent. So much so that Jacob's opponent decided to strike him on the hip and to dislocate it to perhaps even the score. But even then, we are told, Jacob continues to wrestle with strength throughout the night and into the morning, when finally Jacob's opponent asks to be released by him. And Jacob says, I'm not going to release you until you give me a blessing. And the blessing is this: your name shall no longer be called Jacob, but Israel, because you have striven with God and with humans and have prevailed. And so the next morning, a man with a new name and a new limp crossed the river. He faces his brother, and he begins a new chapter in his life.